Why is physics so hard? A lot of us have the passion for physics. You're watching this video after all, but the maths is so difficult. We expect school to teach us the mathematics for us, but for many, it achieves the opposite. It usually demotivates us, telling us we're stupid in formal, standardized ways. Look, when I was at school and plopped in front of equations and pulleys, I didn't get it either. Physicists just seem to get something the rest of us don't, and without it, we struggle. We go back to our star-sized comparison videos and leave the real physics to the experts. But what if this is all wrong? Surely explanations aren't forced to be boring or informative. Is there such a way that we can achieve both? That's what I want to talk about today. Why do you remember interesting events? Beating a game. A childhood TV show. Something stupid your mates did while drunk. It is not that history is intrinsically interesting, but that we only remember the interesting stuff. The stuff that makes good stories. The stuff that we can associate with. Story writers a long time ago figured out what makes stories compelling. You first build some tension, and then you resolve it. There are three simple ways to have someone expect something next, to build narrative tension. Can you think of the first? Using a question draws a general audience and is good for introductions. No one expects the Spanish Inquisition. The same way odd left turns prompt people a good story in a podcast, anything unexpected or unresolved will leave people expecting something more. The final way to build tension is through repetition or rhythm. Since the prior examples started with the example and then an explanation, you naturally fell into the rhythm of such a pattern. You expected another, and hence, this is another way to build tension. Like how a good hammer swing requires a wind-up, it is this tension building that actually drives us forwards in a class or in a lesson. It is this technique that makes books unable to be put down. And it is also the lack of these techniques that makes textbooks and formal classes quite dry and boring. Whatever engages us just sticks in our heads. This is true for stories, but also art and anything with good design in it. How can we use good narrative design to teach physics? Unlike a story, we are all born with some intuition of the natural world. Something doesn't change unless we do something to it. Something has to interact or touch it in order to make it move. These concepts are called causation and locality. Two extremely fundamental ideas in physics that we're all born with. If we already understand causality and locality with such primal instincts, a good explanation of physics should constantly refer to the both of them. The final key to the puzzle is to be fluent in physics. Just stick with me, I'll explain what that means. If I asked you to imagine what a fluent English speaker sounds like, well, it sounds like this. A fluent speaker is able to take words that they already know and apply them to new situations. I didn't learn all these sentences prior to saying them. I got comfortable with the building blocks of English, and I can now make my own sentences. But notice, if I were to ask you instead what a good English speaker sounds like, you imagine someone who can speak a lot of words, has a lot of books, does a lot of writing, a lot of reading, a lot of individual skills. Did you know some famous writers in English weren't entirely fluent in it? They could write and read it, yes, but they couldn't speak it. They couldn't communicate the same way that I am to you. this is something I want to highlight. There's a big difference between just being able to do something and being able to do it fluently. Because of the way schools have to grade people, they usually judge us on strict, standardized, easily measurable ways. For some subjects, maybe it works, but not physics. Physics classes aren't supposed to teach people how to use an equation and plug numbers in blindly. It's supposed to teach us intuitions. It's supposed to teach us how to see the natural world in a new way that gives it even more sense. A successful solution to this problem can be directly stolen from language learners. A native speaker of English can say the same sentence in 20 different ways. A fluent speaker in English can communicate the exact same ideas in 20 different sentences. Instead of practicing a single technique that applies to 20 problems, you should really be looking at the same problem and trying 20 different approaches. Instead of learning proficiency, you should be learning fluency. In summary, if you want to be good at physics, learn to make your own explanations. Try having multiple different explanations for the exact same phenomena. When explaining things to other people or even yourself, ask questions, use rhetorical devices, make it interesting to listen to. We are all human and we can think. None of us are exempt or stupid enough to be excluded from the wonders that is physics. No one should be segregated from humanity's collective marches to understanding the universe in which we live in. Sorry I sounded a little bit pretentious by the end, but hopefully this all kind of makes sense. When I tell to a bored student, make your self-study sessions more interesting, this is kind of what I mean. For teachers, just make it important to give students multiple ways of doing the same problem. Yes, maths is hard, and that will be the main struggle that students will have. But I wasn't fluent in maths when I was born. Like with all acquired languages, if you speak it and if you communicate with it long enough, 你都可以用數學傾偈. Thank you very much for watching and have a good evening.